talks to the camera, right?
Yeah, it's,
yeah.
It's kind of creepy.
Well. Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Devs Play Season 2. We're near the end, and we have a very special episode with a very special guest all the way from Montpellier, France. Michel Ancel, creator of Rayman and Rayman 2 and a whole bunch of other games.
Yeah.
But right now, today, we are going to play Rayman 2 because it was very influential to me when we were making Psychonauts, the original Psychonauts. We also have a very special guest, Lee Petty.
Hello.
Who is very well-versed in the art of the polygon, especially in this era. You're working, making games, and you can explain to us the pain of putting the polygons together.
I spent my youth trying to make it look good.
And this game really, really does look good, and that's, like that segue.
Nice, it's good.
And it's one of the main things we were really inspired by was just how beautiful the textures were and how hand-painted everything looked.
Yeah, the very... when I see all these things, it's crazy because, you know, we started on PC, and PC version was big textures. Mm-hmm. But suddenly someone came during the development and said, your main version is Nintendo 64, so your texture are going to be 64 pixels by 64 with 16 colors. And and it's crazy because so we moved from all these incredible textures to these 16 colors, textures, and we had to translate those things. And
are those textures only 16 colors?
And then these are the original one, because this is the Dreamcast version. And we are really afraid, because suddenly, because the main version was 16 colors, we felt so all this work is lost. And later in the development, someone said, hey, look, we can do the Dreamcast version and take back your wonderful textures and put them in the game. But it was a...
So is this the best version to play?
I think it's, yeah, because that's really the original textures. Yeah. The real first video.
Oh, good. Because this is how I played it. I also were playing this on the Dreamcast today, the greatest console ever released.
It was good.
Yeah.
It was I enjoyed it. I enjoyed
so many good games. Too. And you can see there's a tiny little Rayman running around on the VMU. You'll see that, but there's a little...
Yeah, it's there, running. Yeah.
I forget, is there a game you can play when you pull this out and you can play a Rayman game? Is there like a little runner?
Not sure, but I think remember it's
that one. I just remember the Godzilla one. That was the first one, the Godzilla Tamagotchi type.
So can you kind of set the scene for us, the context? You've already made a Rayman game. Look, actually, let's back up even farther. Your first game. What was your first game that you made?
Yeah, you mean before Rayman?
Yeah. Yeah. Very first game.
Our very first game was like a game I did by myself, because I was so excited to make games that I couldn't wait to have a team, so I decided to do everything I could, and so it was the game was released on Atari ST.
You got it published?
And Amiga, yeah, it was published.
How old were you?
I was 16.
Oh my god,
16.
Okay.
Yeah. And so it was very, very interesting.
What
and,
was it called?
It was The Teller. Very nice thing, there is a connection with Rayman, because I did my own tools and all these things, and at the end of The Teller, I worked on an animation tool, and the first animated character was Rayman.
Oh,
so it was the first Rayman game was on Atari, not released of course, but I could play Rayman on my, and then, like 10 years later, we did this 3D game on the same character, it was unexpected.
So you created Rayman on your own in your teens.
Yeah.
You're still not even 20 yet. And this is before you had a relationship with Ubisoft?
Yeah. It was I first worked on Rayman as an independent developer. But the game became bigger and bigger and bigger, and they hired people to make the game and even grab me in, and that's how I get into the company.
So that, wait a second, you created Rayman, you did?
Yeah.
And you designed him?
Yeah.
Like, outside of the company?
Yeah.
Outside of the, and then they were adding people to it?
Yeah, because the game was first supposed to be on Super Nintendo, CD. But the CD never arrived.
I was going to say, I don't remember that. Okay.
It was crazy. So we were doing like cinematics. We had two people, one programmer and me.
And we were so you did all the work in the first?
All the art, the characters, and the animations. So I learned how to animate, and so that's why the characters very simple, because it was, I didn't knew even how to draw, because I was just manipulating pixels. And but all these things evolved to this game.
Glowbox. How do you say his name?
Glowbox.
Glowbox, okay, good.
And this was the first, Rayman 2 was when you first moved to 3D, correct?
Yeah.
Because Rayman 1 was 2D.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. We discovered everything.
So you made Rayman 1, and that must have done really well, because you made a sequel.
Right. But we, during the two games, we did another Rayman 2, which was 2D.
Yeah.
There's two Rayman 2s?
Yeah.
I missed that one.
Two Rayman 2. Wow. But the one is has never been released.
Oh, it never came out.
It was, the time for 3D games, and so during the development, someone says, okay, no more 2D now.
Hmm. And, so how did the decision get made to make this game and make it 3D?
In fact, it's very interesting because we started this game as a... We wanted to defeat the big structure inside of Ubisoft, because there were another team working on another game with hundreds of people. Mm-hmm. And they were, everything was very... because after the Rayman 1, everyone wanted to make very structured development with a lot of people, mm-hmm. everyone working on a different part. Mm-hmm. And we wanted to prove that it was possible to make games like that with six people. Mm-hmm. So we started, apart from the official development, we started a prototype with a very small team doing the engine and everything from scratch, just to prove that it was possible to make this game. So the first playable version of Rayman in 3D was this kind of demonstration. Look, we can do something, we don't need to be hundreds of people. And
you had to fight within the company to stay small.
Yeah, exactly.
I was always fighting to get more people put on my team. That's pretty amazing. How long did you stay six people?
I think we stayed like that for a couple of months, and then some other people came and they helped us. But it's a nice way to start, very small amount of people, especially when you have to develop the game engine. Otherwise, people are frustrated because it's not working, and we're uh-huh. just figuring out how we can have two polygons on the screen in 30 frames per second. Uh-huh.
You can tell, we were always looking at this for textures. You can kind of see the Psychonauts campground at night skybox, I think, mm-hmm. in this skybox.
Well, it's interesting, 3D games from this era, there's always a couple things I think really, really mark games from this era. One is, when you look at close to those polygons and the lighting on them, it's all per vertex. It's not per pixel,
Do you have a brief way of explaining that?
Yeah.
So, doesn't know what that is?
So nowadays, when you basically light a game, it's every pixel on the screen is just drawn, and it doesn't really matter how many polygons there are, more or less, from a lighting standpoint. So if you want a smooth gradient across just one triangle, you could have that, or multiple triangles. When you get close to these models, these older games were all per vertex, meaning each vertex that made up those models. You can see it blend across it, so you get these kind of almost triangular shading artifacts, I guess you'd call them. And you can see it on Rayman's cheek when you get up close there, and they're really kind of unavoidable. You see it sometimes on the environment, but the environments usually have such rich textures they kind of hide it a little bit. But if you look at the gradient, the way the light falls off, it's usually kind of falling across. If you could imagine a triangle edge on a large square or a rectangle there, you can kind of sort of see that lighting. And I don't know if you guys did this, but I remember one of the techniques we used to use, and you mentioned earlier about having 16 colors. A lot of times you would keep the color palette of an individual texture relatively small, and you'd use the lighting, you kind of oversaturate the lighting to bring back some of the color, because you didn't have as much range to work with in the texture. It would just get all posterized and lots of dots and artifacts if you put too much color in there.
Yeah, it's very funny to see that the background is made with 200 polygons, and mm-hmm. so it's giant polygons with painting on them. And this specific one is very nice, because I did the first draft of this this place.
You painted the background, or you modeled it?
Yeah, the background and the overall, this what we call a graphic kit. So this, uh-huh. this kit was supposed to be the jungle. But there's no trees, because we don't have polygons for trees.
Yeah.
So you see those roots that you can think that are trees, and even when you look up, you
it
see
kind of suggests that there's trees there.
Yes, suggests that, and I was inspired by My Neighbor Totoro, the movie from Miyazaki.
It's one of my favorites.
And if you look at the ground and the colors, cold and warmer colors are really the nest of Totoro.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
It's the same spirit. I really love this very ancient nest mm-hmm. in a very old tree with big roots.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I just put some very quickly some just I was painting the good thing with this kind of way of making background is that you just draw one texture and you have already an overall atmosphere. On it.
Yeah. It's true. The textures really had to do a lot of the work, you know, like the nowadays it's there's still shaders are huge and important for different reasons, but the mesh can contribute so much. I mean, if you just go one generation forward to like the PlayStation 3 era, you know, it's primarily about a lot of those polygonal shapes. Here, it's so much as just in the texture. I mean, it's just a flat polygon, you know. But
uh-huh.
It's also interesting is you don't run into nowadays when you play like traversal or platform games, like you're never really sure like where the ledge is to grab or where to go in a 3D game because there's so much visual fidelity and noise and softening. But here. Uh-huh. You know, because you couldn't really avoid it with the low polygon count. There's always such an obvious edge, and it does kind of help playability in its way, though. You know, you always kind of know where you're going.
I love that little
witching grid.
Sad glow boxes.
The UV scrolling tears, is that what that was?
Yes, UV
yeah. scrolling. Like, this is in an era, like, kind of an in-between era, like, just having polygons is still so exciting back then. It's hard to remember, like, I remember playing, like, when you look at the first Tomb Raider now, you're like, wow, the textures and everything, and the way it looks so rough, and...
Yeah.
I don't remember feeling that way at all when I was playing it, because I just remember it was so neat still to mm-hmm. be in 3D and to have, like, seeing the inside of the glowbox's mouth. Like, everything would be so much more complicated now. And so,
yeah.
But I just remember feeling really just excited that look what this mushroom's doing.
Kind of dancing. It's an homage to Rayman 1, because Rayman 1 had a lot of living stuff everywhere, so mm-hmm. you wanted to reduce it. Just sprites, they're just
yeah.
facing
just like,
the camera.
Yeah, the camera, yeah.
And trying to climb on each other. So it was, and you have the
crazy,
mosquito from the first Rayman too.
Crazy mosquito. Mm-hmm. Okay. And all of those little windows, like what is that window too?
Yeah, it's same thing.
On? Is there a cottage there? Is there a little guy in there?
Yeah, we wanted to give the feeling that it's a place where people can live, and so this is a crazy place in the game because it's not in the rule of game design that you could write on paper or you learn at school, game design school. It's this place is just, you go there, you have got those butterflies and you've got this new move that allows you to go mm-hmm. up, and it's not used anymore in the game or very,
ever?
Like, three times. So it's like very exotic gameplay that you do once. It's really
is
something
it really
that
once
is
a couple. It's kind of a couple. More
really
times.
few times.
We had that in Psychonauts. We would make some ability for rats, like climbing ladders or climbing on sliding or rail slides. And then we found some of them were not being used. They would be used once, and we're like, mm-hmm. wait, that we made these so they'd be cool. You got to put them. I eventually had to make this document that was like, the following elements must be in every level: one rail slide, one ladder. We didn't program those ladders for nothing, people. And I love that. I always love how you handled the camera so that you... Because how else would you ever see that purple
yeah,
lung
yeah.
there?
It's a teasing.
No, I think I don't have the ability to grab that thing yet, right?
Yeah.
You gotta hit him twice. And that, like, basic cage is still in, like, the most current Rayman game, right? So the knocking people out of cages.
Yeah.
You smash them open.
The guy's sneaking over and he's gonna steal the crown. Hilarious. Did you do the animation?
No, I did not animate this. The people who were animating were also the ones who did the storyboard and all the dialogues. And is the man is Jacques Exartier. He's the writer behind Rayman 2 and Beyond Good and Evil 2.
Mm-hmm.
And what is coming from the animation industry. You know, he was doing movies and he was an animator, senior paper animator. You know, doing. Mm-hmm. Frame by frame animation and paper, and it was his first 3D 3D game, and even 3D animations.
Well, you can see the animators still have that problem nowadays. Anytime you make a texture, the rule is, of course, anytime you make a texture and you put it in a game, and the animators have a chance to shove the camera right up into it to make it look blurry and pixelated, they will.
Mostly the artists will fight with the programmers. But
yeah.
One way to start a fight between the animators and
yep.
the artists is to be asked for a real, can I have a close up there?
Yeah.
And they'll zoom in and the artist will be like, I didn't paint that well enough.
The best part is to say, yeah, just pick a set somewhere in the world, and instinctively the animators will pick the least polished area and do this great animation there, and then the world person who made the world will see it and they cry and they have to make it better. Is that another technique? Just to like get all those areas of the world polished?
Mm-hmm.
Put a cutscene there?
Mm-hmm. This part doesn't look very good. Let's put it on camera really. Ooh, space. scrolling. There's a forest space. With a hole that leads to space. Where am I exactly? Where is this whole world set? This crazy thing.
I think, yeah, the idea is that you are really in the very ancient part of the world of Rayman with all these, like a sacred place with tricks to jump from one place to another that only wizards share with each other.
Do you remember any specific artistic inspirations other than Miyazaki that you had when you were first creating the world and characters of Rayman?
I think we had one main, you see there are some kind of leaves drawn on the main, so it's really every temples have a main theme. Mm-hmm. And represent something in that world. So it's not really an outside overall reference, it's just the idea that here the mythology around this place is really about nature and forest. And so during the adventure, you've got all these different places with different themes. So you see all the drawings and the sculpted things. It's a game where we wanted to give the people the thing that they are in a world that exists, that has some mythologies and you know things are not just visual, that they have a purpose. And
yeah, I think playing and creating games, that's my favorite part is to try and make or experience someone else's idea of a complete world. You know, just like the fact that the sense that the world has its own mythology and characters and story that's older and outside just the game itself. I always find that to be... I always got that sense from Rayman too, like there was a... I always felt like maybe it was based on a fairy tale or something that I just wasn't familiar with.
Yeah. Where is that llama mist? Ask some more art questions when I find this. I'm going to get really obsessive about this. There.
No. Well, I did notice, and I remember this too all the time, is that, you know, nowadays you when people have transparency, like soft edge things like leaves and stuff, they use what would just be called an alpha blending transparency, you know, like a soft transparency. And back then it was all different names for it, but like one bit or cookie cutter, it's just everything is black and white, so you get these kind of like jaggy hard edges whenever you want like a sprite in the world. But I just saw, like, we just went by one where that didn't have that did have some soft alpha on it, and I remember this was kind of the generation where some games would start to use that, but you still had sorting problems, so you had to be very careful, like you could only use one layer of it. You couldn't have, you know, do you remember struggling with that when you're trying to make a forest? Or
how did I miss that?
My heart is beating right now. I don't even listen to everything, you know, it was just,
I never do.
I was looking at the hub, and when you look at the hub, you have the feeling that it's a lung inside of the game, but you
were you worried that it really could not have been a bug, of course. It was obviously my playing. And it's behind a waterfall. I always consider it a bug if there's a waterfall that does not have something hidden.
Yeah, that's true. It's like a toilet that's not interactive.
Yeah, he's like, yeah, of course, yeah. Of course. You
have to have interactive toilet. Waterfalls have to have secrets. These are game
And toilets rules. Are waterfalls, so I think we have the whole cycle.
Yeah, it's like a loop. Yeah. So you have to have something magical inside of every toilet.
So of course when you flush away, you can look if there is a secret or something.
Okay.
Okay, guys, we are coming back.
We got it, yeah.
They should look at you. No,
no. I'm going to find
what is he doing?
For the special edition, you can add that. Let's see. Okay, I'm going to save your dad, I swear, you guys. I just need to practice this. You know, I played this game and I never noticed that this chimney climb never came back. Were you really into rock climbing at the time of making this game?
Sorry?
Were you a rock climber? Is that why you have this move in here?
I just... I thought it was an interesting way of, you know, jumping and you decide why you want to stop. And so it was more of the fun of that than my real skills in climbing, which are terrific. But I think when you're doing games, you try to do things you don't do in real life, and it's like a way to...
All the time. So who designed the levels of this game? Did you design a lot of them or all of them?
I did specifically those first levels were designed. We are close to the level designers because they were very important to learn the game. Mm-hmm. So those early levels were really the ones we did and did again and again until it was fluid. And it's funny because when I see that more than I don't know, it's like 16 years later, this is the...
Change it a little bit.
This is one of my favorites. Mm. I like that level because you have a secret passage in the water. If you, if you swim, you have a you have an entry.
Wait a second.
I already figured out you're kind of waterfall challenged him. So.
I have a phantasm in a game. I should. I think I've never done it in my game, but I'd love to have a secret passage like that where it never ends, like you, like kilometers, you know, and you.
Which just becomes like desert
and
bus.
You the
just
more
go on
you
forever.
Go in this kind of passage, the bigger you think the surprise or the benefit is going to be. So, I'm wondering after. How many times the guys decide to go back, which is like half an hour to come back, or decide to continue for an enormous amount of
time. But it's infinite. It never ends.
I don't know.
At the very end, there's a screen that pops up that says, format hard drive, yes or okay. Those are your only two options. And then you don't know if you should shut it off or stop making eye contact. Or.
What would you say was the biggest influence on this game? Was it Mario 64? Just make it up from scratch. Right? I think we never played those games.
No, the main thing from Mario was the control, because Mario was the first game to have a control relative to the character, to the camera, sorry. And the other, you know, where you were controlling characters like cars, like characters.
Yeah. Like turn left, right, and go forward.
You
know, like
the tank controls. Do you remember that?
And Mario was the first game that was relative to the
crazy
camera.
People would do that.
Tomb Raider 1 was all tank controls, too.
All the best
games. It was car control, yeah.
I like calling them car controls of tank controls.
I do. It sounds less aggressive. That explains, you know, the American term has to be more aggressive. It's tank controls.
But a lot of people don't, like, you take it for granted now that you just push a joystick and the character will go where you push it, but that was not done in Mario 64.
And when we did that on Rayman, people at Ubisoft, they were like, "Oh, crazy!
Yeah.
What are you doing? Yeah. This is not the car control."
Oh, I can't.
I think when you do this kind of thing with Lara Croft, it's okay because you see some part of the body more than others. You know, this car control. But for Rayman, we don't have the same interest in the body, so it's better to have this.
He has no parts. Some of his body parts are missing.
Yeah.
Is this the game where he has an idle animation where he actually juggles his body?
I think if you don't do anything,
I'll find out later. I'll do that later when I'm stuck. Now, I can't jump in the water. Where am I going?
I think you can kill the piranhas or shoot at them, and then you break their teeth.
Do you remember running into any specific limitations about how big your levels could be because of memory or stream? Because I mean, we weren't really streaming games back then, right? We kind of load it statically, and there wasn't a lot of game streaming, right? So you couldn't have giant levels.
Yeah,
you
know? In fact, I must admit something that happened in the development of that game again. That's where we were on PC running it was very smooth, big textures, and suddenly we went on Nintendo 64, and the game was at 30 frames per second with just Rayman in a cube. And then we do a big meeting with everyone. So this is where we are now. We are one character, 12 triangles, and we are at 30 frames per second. So if you look at all the levels here, they are made so that it's just, you know, it looks like an intestine, like the inside of a body, because you have this
you break the
cave,
sight lines constantly.
And then you have these small corridors that are just to. Filter the content, and everything is built like that. You have to make everything so that you don't feel too much that you are in the intensity of a game developer.
I remember it was always challenging because, and I can see that in this level too, is the walls are so high, and you know you're outdoors, but it's you have to be very careful about when you let players have a nice vista view because there's so few things you can draw and things you have to unload. And
it was crazy the amount of constraints we have for Nintendo 64 because it was the leading version of the game.
I remember Nintendo 64 hardware at the time also was really aggressive about. It's filtering, so the textures got very, very, very soft. Yeah. You know, like even if they were reasonable size, they still got very soft. It was very difficult to make certain art styles on that platform. You know, and you look at some of the best-looking stuff, Nintendo 64 was pretty much just flat shaded because, you know, they had small textures and the textures they had there got really soft. I mean, Mario 64 is a great example of primarily just smooth color shapes, you know.
This is a nice level because the structure of the level is nice. You have the secret passage under the water, hidden cages, so the challenge of staying on the route.
I know, I'm terrified right now.
You see the exit from the beginning, so it's nice because it's showing the objectives, you have sight things, and it's...
And it feels like there are multiple ways to just move through the world.
It's a nice...
pretty UV scrolling waterfall.
Should we explain what UV scrolling is? Do most people know what UV
scrolling is? If I know what it is, I'm sure everyone knows. Go ahead. It means ultraviolet.
It means ultraviolet scroll, exactly. Yeah. Now, UVs refers to the way you map textures onto a polygon. And to give the illusion of of movement, those coordinates would just be moved along an axis. So rather than, say, generate particles or actually have a truly animated object, it's just a matter of scrolling a texture on a static, non-moving polygon. And in these early days, that's pretty much one of the most effective cheap ways that you could do stuff like waterfalls, or I saw some smoke earlier that volcano that had that same technique. It's tricky. I mean, we still use it occasionally. It's still in modern games, really? Still use it.
Yeah, of course.
But it's not to the extent that it was used back then. It was one of the primary tools for kind of world, making the world not static. Yeah, that looks like another UV scroll there, right?
Can you look a little bit to the left? Yeah, so this is clearly a reference to Day of the Tentacle. These guys are, I like this part where they put dark bad things on clear water, you know. So the idea here was the first time you see the bad guys, mm-hmm. what they're doing in the environment. And it was just a contrast between the very clear water and the dark stuff getting out. So it's a UV texture, but because the texture is doing a sinus, you have the feeling that it's a fluid or something.
You like a sine wave, so it gives a feeling.
Yeah.
If you get the speed right, it gives the illusion.
It's funny because it was our first 3D game, and each time there was something like that in the team, people were like, what are we doing? It's so beautiful. Uh-huh. Look, it looks like real water. Uh-huh. Oh, we are like, wow. Sometimes I think it's good to self-satisfaction, you know. It's very important in your life.
I remember having all those same thoughts. Anytime, the first time you see something, your mind just makes it seem like it couldn't get any better. Like, you know, uh-huh. and then yeah. you look back on it and you're like, what was I thinking? You know, it's just, but for the time, you feel clever because you sort of cheated the limitations.
When you watch a movie you haven't seen in 10 years and you're like, I never noticed these special effects are bad before, but I remember seeing this and thinking how cool they were. And you wonder what happened to your brain that like made you able to see that.
It's true. I guess it just goes to show the importance of looking at outside things for inspiration and reference, you know, like looking at other people's work and other mediums, because if you just stay so locked in just what you're doing, you kind of lose perspective.
Mm-hmm. I just killed a little caterpillar.
Yeah, that's mean.
You just circle the tree to make sure you don't mess around.
Hey, look, they're doing something very clever there. It looks like they have a vine decal on top of the polygon, so it breaks the silhouette up a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How am I supposed to hit that without seeing that, Michelle? How am I supposed to... just jump lower. Okay.
Just be better.
I'm just arguing with myself.
Yeah, you really have to use the helicopter to control the jump.
Yeah. And the shadow. You can't do a platform without a good shadow.
Saved by the shadow. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure.
That's not real lighting either. It's just like a scaling blob, right? Like, because it's not...
The shadow? Yeah. It's just a disc.
I was trying to see if the character lighting changed at all, and I remember a lot of times in games of this era, what we do is, you know, he's darker in darker environment, but he's still the same color, but sometimes, you know, it'd have a very simple sampler, right? And just kind of look at the pixel or a sampler near the ground, and it would just overall darken or lighten the whole character, because it was too expensive to do real lighting.
Yeah. What is very funny about this game is that there were two teams, one team in Montpellier with very experienced people, mm-hmm. and because it was time for the game to be released, and Ubisoft hired a lot of young artists, level designers, and so we, from game developers, we became teachers, mm-hmm. and this was very interesting, and at the same time it was a bit difficult. But when I see all these things, I remember that it was made by beginners. So they were in Paris, sometimes we were visiting them, helping them. Mm-hmm. So this is a video game, it's interactive, because they were just getting out of the art school. They have never seen a game just before. And we were already veteran, we have made game for like 10 years before. So it's very interesting, because especially this part, this level, with this point of view, was made by a young artist. And we had to explain the constraints of polygons and efficiency, you know. Mm-hmm. And here, this point of view, the camera is a very nice use of the camera, because it's creating this dramatic vision of the, you see the guy from the bottom, and it's very...
I saw that puzzle really quick. Yeah. It's super smart.
The use of the camera is... We were spending a lot of time tweaking the camera in every area.
It really seamlessly moves from full control to like rail cams or all sorts of pivot cams and special or we call security cameras, like
pole cameras, right? It's like on a point moving around.
I thought it was too loud. And it goes back and forth, and you don't really notice until you like try to push the camera push button. You get that little no camera thing.
Yeah, as long as it's in the direction of the gameplay, you don't feel the you don't have the need to move it, so it's okay. But it was kind of rules we needed to. So I think you can shoot it.
I still feel like camera is one of the hardest things in games. I feel like it's never been fully solved. It's just been understood, and you still put a ton of effort into it. Like, you know, like games that have really beautiful cameras, like the Naughty Dog games, you know, they have a lot of people that just spend time on those cameras.
This is a nice point of view, too. Mm-hmm. Because it's a kind of old-fashioned 2D game, you know, LCD game, mm-hmm. where you have to go right, left, with the right timing.
Looks like you changed the field of view on the camera, too, for that shot, right? It's got like a more fisheye feel to it.
Yeah,
it changes the experience quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. And this is another thing I think was an influence on Psychonauts, just that basic assumption that it wouldn't be just platforming, the exact same thing. Like, there's a lot of variety in the camera angles and the activity you're doing. There are a lot of special case areas and sliding ones. These guys are coming out at the same time.
Maybe you go to the right.
Okay. Oh, no! I wonder if I went back to my checkpoint. Oh, yeah, here we go.
This is a nice shot, though.
Wow. And people like robots and they like pirates, so it's pretty much money in the bank right there.
Robot pirates.
I'm getting worse. Okay, I'm gonna do this. Unless you want to do it, Michelle. Do you think you could still do it?
Yeah.
Let's see. You haven't played this for how long?
I think it's, I can shoot him.
Shoot him all the way back there?
Yeah.
That's a good idea.
I didn't play since 1999.
Did you have any rules for like what Rayman would and wouldn't do? Like, is he...
Touching his right leg or something like that?
like morals? Like, he wouldn't murder someone? Like, he wouldn't rip a head off? He would just...
I mean, he's pretty friendly. He shoots people with his mind, though. He's killing those robots.
I think we were... not really questioning ourselves too much for this kind of games.
Yeah. I was about to say you're much better at this than I am.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, it's no meat circus.
No. But this, yeah. Takes a lot of work to do a meat circus. It seemed like the barrels, they change their rhythm sometimes, and when I was doing it, they were coming out really close to each other. Not to say that this is much easier for you, but...
I think it's...
You didn't have generative stuff. Tim, this is all just scripted. Come on.
Yes.
You know, I was just looking at this level, and it's kind of a dark level, you know, just in terms of the value, the colors. And I remember all the time that it was hard to get, the way most vertex lighting was done by then, your texture could only get darker. They didn't have an oversaturation.
Yeah, it was negative.
You know, it would just multiply against it. And so unless you painted your textures very bright, your levels just tended to be a little darker than you thought they would be when you see them in the game. I remember struggling with that all the time. You could never get a light to like blow out a surface to white, you know?
And the artists who did most of the texture, they were coming from 2D games, and they were used, you know, to tweak the texture's saturation so that it's always less saturated than the main, and less contrast, mm-hmm. less contrasted than the main characters.
Right.
In order to get to have detailed,
yeah.
without you see here the saturation of the character is on purpose is more important than saturation of the background, which is things we were doing on two old 2D arcade games, you know, like tweaking this, and it's crazy because I'm looking, even if you look at most of the Nintendo games like Mario Kart today, they use all those rules, you know, for the road is always less saturated, mm-hmm. and there is a real big balancing with contrast, saturations, and all these things, which is really the heritage of the old arcade game time.
Yeah, I feel like there's an era definitely where people struggled with readability in games, you know, having the right elements stand out, because you just didn't have quite all the tools you wanted to, you know. We first started getting lots of dynamic lighting or particles, and the camera wasn't perfect. It was really hard to kind of control things. Or like a 2D game, you could, like you said, you could just sort of make your mid-ground less and your background really light, but you know, when you're moving the camera around, it's really difficult in these early games.
I remember that it was really hard on Psychonauts to get. We got some artists outside the game industry, and who'd never worked in 3D before, and the hardest thing was to get them not paint shadows into the art, It's just so natural to paint beautiful lighting into the textures, but you're like, no, you gotta let the engine light everything.
Well, and with Psychonauts 1 in this game, it was always a balance because you had to paint some lighting in because there was no real dynamic lighting and it could be placed in different parts of the world. But if it was too strong, like too strong with cast shadows, it would look incorrect as well, you know? So it was always that like fine art, like you could see those nice wooden, that wooden floor texture there has some lighting in it. It's not just completely like what they'd flatten out.
You can climb on the grid.
Like the rock wall.
And I think a lot of that was like, it also changed with the Xbox when you were supposed to. They're really encouraging to use pixel shaders.
Yeah.
Like, come on, we got pixel shaders now.
Yeah. And they were never quite good enough in the first Xbox. The Xbox 360 and later, for sure, you could kind of like make up, you know, you had enough going on with lighting and the shading that you could, there was a good reason to not put in the texture. I always kind of felt like that first generation was always really difficult to get. It was kind of like half dynamic, half static. Yeah, it was. I think still like the best looking games of that era still had a lot of lighting information painted just right into the textures. Mm-hmm. Lasers and games, still good.
Mm-hmm. I like the stairs that are painted on the ramps.
Mm-hmm. Let's wake up that guy.
Wake him up with death. Don't forget the strafing on the left trigger. Let me give you some tips. Pick up all the lums.
I'm looking for another stick for the camera.
Oh my god! Bum, 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 bum.
Do you feel like if you're making a platformer nowadays, I was just seeing you die here, it was just reminding me.
We are going to make a platformer.
I know, that was a setup, Tim. Thanks for ruining it. No, I was going to say, like, I remember there was, I felt like just from a popular, I felt like the average gamer, or at least the assumption was the average gamer was okay dying a lot more and replaying segments within a platformer than, at least on a bigger game today. I wonder if, I don't know, do you think it has to be easier to make a successful platformer nowadays?
I don't know, man. Like I'm used to it in a game like Limbo, like you just die and go back and die and go back.
It's not really a platformer though, right?
I guess
there's some platforming in it.
It's more of a puzzle, I guess.
But you can't really pass those puzzles until you see it fail once. Yeah. Like they're specifically designed for that, right? But like you not being able to say jump between lasers, you know what you're doing, you just like mistimed it or whatever, right? It's a little different.
Wait, maybe. What's her name? Who's that? With the Lee. Green lips.
Yeah, so this is Lee, female character in there.
Oh, L-Y. Right,
yeah, right.
L-Y. Robots everywhere.
Pop.
Look at you strafing in there. Sneaking in there.
So you're gonna make Psychonauts 2 really hard, Tim?
That's the question you're asking. I don't know, should we have difficulty modes so we can go really, really high?
I don't know if I like difficulty. Difficulty modes are weird because you sort of have to decide before you play it.
Yeah.
And you don't really know. Like, I don't know. It's tricky. I think they've always been kind of problematic that way.
Mm-hmm. Or you just dynamically make it easier as people. I hate when I figure out that a game has dynamic difficulty.
Yeah.
Because like, I finally beat that boss. Or did the boss just let me beat it?
Well, it's also really hard to predict what people are actually wanting to do. You know, I feel like sometimes in games, I kind of like to just wander around a bit. Like I fight a combat, instead of going right to the next scenario, I like to wander around a bit. And so many modern games are filled with nag lines, like, are you lost? They're just assuming you're lost. But you're like, no, I'm just enjoying the beautiful artistry of this world and listening and looking at the details. And I don't know. And then that kind of ruins that vibe to have the game being, but then other people might just be lost. Now, it's really hard to guess exactly what they're doing.
You have to be running forward and throwing, right?
Should be okay. Just the time to remember the mechanic.
That lightning looks pretty advanced for the era. Looks pretty good.
Wow, bravo.
That lightning.
That's a kind of cool mechanic to toss something in the air and then shoot something.
Tim, did you see the cool skulls coming out of the smoke thing?
Yeah, they look a little bit like toast. Like poison toast. So you have to stop running, throw in the air, shoot.
Okay, not there.
Poison toast. Don't poison toast. Remind me of the skull in Peter Pan, the animated Disney.
Yeah, well, Nightmare Before Christmas kind
of. Like on the big skull.
That bomb looks so non-threatening as it kind of just moves towards you, like, la 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 la.
I'm the little bomb in the dark. should be a song here.
There you go. Bomb.
That's it for that one.
A bunch of sprites got out. How many designers were on the team altogether?
A few designers. Most of the team was level designers. Mm-hmm. I think we had two game designers. like doing really the rules and setting the different elements, but most of the people were level designing and...
Did any of his mechanics come in, like were they all set in the beginning and then the level designers just used them, or did you add any later?
Yeah, we did some prototypes with those things and just trying to figure out if it was really something you could reuse enough times. And but the very nice thing is that we are really creating those ingredients and trying to give them to the level designers, letting them finding how they can combine things. And if it was not, you know, inspiring for them, we are throwing away everything. But sometimes it was difficult to know if it was because of the guy, because of the ID. So we had to test by ourselves. And but best is when you have surprises from those ingredients. Like you do them and you have gameplay sequences, emergent things that comes out of that.
Those places in a combination you didn't expect. In
yeah, yeah, and sometimes some unexpected things arrives, and it really depends on the people.
Let me load up a later one. Let's see.
Do you remember anything that you sort of guys weren't planning on having that you kind of accidentally discovered when people put the mechanics together? And
most of the game is...
Most of
the game? You know, like the trampoline thing was completely unexpected. It was really... First, it was just mechanic to grab things. It was not supposed to be a gameplay or... So it's part of the magic. You just do very little simple things and try to... It's really about economy. Try to do to take the best out of very simple things. Because on the other side, the player needs to understand all those things. So if you have too much new mechanics, it's hard for them to... So it's better to try to do most different you know, experience with the same ingredients.
I was trying to remember what the story is about Rayman. Like, is he a regular person in this world, or he dropped into this world?
He's a kind of creature made by the fairies to, you know, but it's a kind of, he's supposed to be a kind of error in the system, you know, something that they wanted to do a real hero with muscles and all these things. And well,
they summoned a great hero.
Yeah,
and
they summoned
Rayman doesn't have the arms and legs.
Big nose and even, yeah, he can't take people in his arms.
He's got a zero on him. What, which level should we go to? You know all these levels. Which one has something cool that we should check out?
Maybe you could try the root one. It's a difficult one.
This
one
here?
One with the lava and roots and...
Okay, that'll be different. Hey, look, there's even a slide in your hub world. That's fancy.
Beneath the sanctuary of rock and lava.
It's like a Game of Thrones book.
You're gonna play the Red Wedding level now?
Me?
I said I wasn't going to make an Aronofsky reference this time. That's not Aronofsky.
Oh, there's some throbbing.
Those we had problems with those roots.
What were your problems with the roots?
Yeah, I will show you.
I find them very alluring.
Yeah.
Are those the ones you were telling me about?
Yeah, they are those ones, yeah. You could do a whole movie with those roots.
There's not a point of view camera in this site. You can't look around the world in the game. She has a...
Is it a body tattoo?
Green lips. Doesn't Jade have green lips?
Yeah.
Is she Jade? Is that the connection between these worlds?
A hidden secret between the two games?
Or do you just... that you're just into the green lips thing?
That's
just
that's my feeling.
Did I just get power? Ooh, new powers. I'm glad we skipped to this load. Yay! Is that your voice?
No.
Who is the voice of
Rayman? No, I don't know.
I don't know who the voice of Rayman is.
Yeah, I don't know if that. I'm not crazy with that voice. I never knew exactly where it came from. And
hey, Rayman!
I wanted something more like, you know, depth, you know, bass voice.
You thought he would have a
deep... Oh, I'm Rayman.
Really? That's your Rayman voice?
Yeah.
I like the stained glass here. Is that
disappointment for me.
Yeah, that is actually, look at how high resolution it is.
I can't think of Rayman having any other voice except for the, yay!
You could have the Gears of War voice type.
Wait, do Rayman's voice again?
Yeah, that's it. So when you jump, I can...
Wait, how can I go over this? It's lava.
You have to use your new power, no?
I didn't even see what my new power was. What did she say my new power was? Do I have to go swing through?
I think you can just use your helicopter forever and fly like a bird. Freedom!
Oh, that's
freedom!
This was a bug that you could do in Psychonauts.
Freedom! And then you will see the roots very closely.
Jump into the sexy roots.
So, yeah, this is something that, you know.
So, what did
at the end of the development, a guy came and said, I found something in the game. Porn! Porn, Michel, look! Those roots, look the movements. Ah. And there is a place where there is a symmetry in the roots. And you have those two roots with the big spikes going inside, outside, forever.
How long did he spend trying to find it? That's what
I spent hours finding the porn roots.
And we're going to, too.
Try to find them.
I mean, they all look pretty sexy.
I think we...
This looks like a bunch of good friends hanging out.
I like them because they're both male and female at the same time.
I can't even...
They're all... It's good. It's not... They're very naughty.
You can go inside.
About their sensuality.
I'm in there.
Yeah, you can continue.
Oh, you mean I can go up and there's a little tunnel?
Yeah.
Oh, that's the place you actually have to go. Except for these
watch out for the little...
Oh, yeah, look! Here! It's still in the game. Oh, my God. So, look. Okay. It's still there.
Where?
So, I've seen it. So, turn the camera.
You gotta rotate around.
Oh, it's crazy. Rotate a little bit the camera.
I gotta tap this thing and rotate around. I can't tap! Can't rotate. I gotta come back this direction. Okay, let me drop out a little bit and then...
Right, good.
I've seen it. It's very. It's more than. It's a kind of.
You think he was right?
I think he's not. He was. I understand the trauma.
The trauma. Yeah.
So you can never unsee the undulating roots.
Yeah.
Good. I've seen it.
You've seen it before,
you know,
though, right?
I spent like 10 years to forget. More than 10 years, and now it's going to come back to me.
All coming back.
Touch those walls.
So I think. Look here on the left part of the screen.
Oh yeah.
Oh, it's like a mirrored, like, symmetry going on.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I am traumatized.
I'm trying not to say anything. I like it.
Yeah, I mean...
Do you see it again? Oh, yeah, look, in the corner. Yeah, in front of me. You have this symmetry thing.
I think if this guy was comparing that too closely to anything... porn, he's been traumatized beforehand, is what I'm saying.
I mean, all the teeth and the spikes on it?
This is like maybe Cthulhu porn. Like, astral sea erotica.
Yeah.
You see it?
It's the profile of JF Kennedy.
Yeah.
Right?
I see a saint, or maybe Mary.
So
you're in the tunnel of porn.
There's a lot of them kind of disappearing into darkness that... Maybe some people would find trouble.
I wonder if I ever went to this area. Is this like a secret area, or do you have to go there?
I have to go there.
Okay.
Razorbeard. That's a good name. Razor
I think
Beard.
I can
that's
shoot
like a
the...
name.
Who's Razorbeard?
It said even Razorbeard's afraid of you, so that's one of the bad guys, right?
Yeah, Razorbeard. He's the chief of the pirates.
Razorbeard, that's good.
Yeah. I think you can shoot that.
You're gonna shoot the porn?
Shoot the porn, man.
And so, was that someone on Ubisoft trying to take it out? Like, we gotta take out
they wanted us to remove it. I think we were so happy to have something like that we just didn't remove it. Okay, come shoot that.
I don't think you can shoot that. You gotta go over it. Skill.
Tension.
Oh man, this is really tense. This is so funny.
Because you have all that porn that...
I know, so you gotta try not to think about sex while you're going through here. It's really hard.
That's the tension. It's mixing primal, sexual...
Oh, now I feel like I'm surrounded by undulating, just... weird.
I think we are going to see it again, I'm afraid. We have all these spikes.
Weird forest orgy.
Look at that. That's what we call a butt stab in the video game industry, where an unexpected thing comes out and kills you.
Little wiggle.
I don't know, that wasn't much
it
broadcasting.
It would geek, and then it was like, and then it went.
That was like half a second.
That's a really pretty fire texture. Look at it, it's got like a Sleeping Beauty quality to it.
It's got a little Psychonauts quality, too.
Oh, there is a wind. Yeah, so I have two. Wind and flame and porn.
How far into the game?
But this is really heavy metal. You should
love
that.
Yeah,
it is
very metal.
It is heavy metal.
If we do Brutal Legend 2, we're gonna have
a kind of hell
sexy thorn tunnel in it.
Sexy thorn tunnel. Yeah, that's good. The Briar.
That's also my new Tinder name. Sexy thorn tunnel.
And you get those balls of hairs attacking you.
Balls of they're like Totoro but mean.
Soot demons, soot gremlins.
How are you gonna? This has gotta be a thought. This isn't even the last level in the game. This is just.
See, we're starting. Maybe now Meat Circus doesn't look so bad.
Yeah. And they run at different speeds, those little spinning pyramids of fire. He's surviving. I'm glad I'm not playing right now.
Yeah, it'd be embarrassing.
Yeah.
Don't die now.
Diamond.
Don't look at the
leaving
sexy branches.
The thorn.
this is the kind of lighting the cigarette after the act.
section, for the right? Golden flow. Lava flow.
Can't get there. Ah, you're gonna die!
Ah, no. Okay.
Anyway, so.
I like that lava, dude.
Yeah, that was cool, and I love that stained glass. You did it. Bravo. You still got it. 10 years
later. I escaped the porn.
Happens with age.
Could be the name of the mission.
I escaped the porn.
Ah, so here I have to bounce. Okay, to use the.
I don't remember this part.
It's just got
a. Because I breeze through so easily.
It's got a very Art Nouveau sort of. You guys inspired by the metro in France or something?
Yeah. You're right. The Art Nouveau and, of course. Beginning of the 20th century, like Musha, and mm-hmm. We did a lot of research at the beginning of the game.
Is that how you say that, Musha?
Musha, yeah.
I think they always call him Mucha.
Mucha. Yeah.
So, what was the production like on this game? Did you was it easy the whole time, smooth sailing?
I think it was the most difficult part was the working with all the beginners and the mm-hmm. young guys and. It was.
How long was the game in development?
It was about two years and a half.
And how did management feel about the game the whole time? Did they like it the whole time? Were they supportive of it, or they're like, "What are you doing?" Was this like Heart of the Darkness? They're like, "Michel's gone crazy. He's gone too deep. He's gone too deep. He's gone too ambitious."
No, I think they were happy because we had nice results very early. So even if the game was not finished, we had some interesting things. And you see, this kind of level is not using a lot of, it's just the same simple mechanics. So as long as it was just using what we had and not demanding new production values, things, and mm-hmm. it was okay.
So you're saying the game showed it as being fun really quickly?
Yeah.
That was a really hard thing for us on Psychonauts. It's like we're putting the engine together and then putting all these different mechanics together, all these different features, and it was really hard to just put them all together and make it fun really quick. Like, it took a long time to make it.
Wow.
You're also building an engine.
Wow.
Ooh.
Where am I supposed to go from here?
Okay, left. You can do it. Just shoot. Can you shoot?
Not the form!
Everybody, lean. No.
You know, it's like in virtual reality, you're moving with the. I like when mm-hmm. we were playtesting and having people, like that. Mm-hmm. Having the feeling that there is a gyroscope or something inside of the joystick and it can help if you.
You made it.
It's reduced to nothingness. Well done.
Access denied.
Where are my applause? Where are my enthusiasm and crazy support? Jealous. Not jealous.
Jealous.
I beat the porn.
How'd you make the game fun right away?
Sorry?
What was the secret to making the game fun right away? I need to know.
I think it's really the you take the pad, you put it to in the hand of a naive human, and mm-hmm. you expect him to have fun more than, and you do it repeat until you bring pleasure to others. Yeah, playtesting a lot.
From the very beginning.
Yeah, from the very beginning. Just that's the truth. It's only coming from this time when you give the joystick to someone else because. You will have another point of view, and sometimes people have fun in places you expect to be boring or you don't have, mm-hmm. And you discover that it's something you can keep.
Mm-hmm. Who built these robots? What is this about? Technology encroaching on humanity and nature?
Yeah, that's the basic idea that these guys just come and they want to take everything out of out of the nature and. They're selling everything, they're selling the creatures, and so they're capturing everything to sell them across the universe, mm-hmm. all these exotic pets. I like that part because it's a time where the guy has no more, the bad guy has no more ways to defeat Rayman, so he's calling a military guy, mm-hmm. a weapon seller. Mm-hmm. So it's like, those government where they buy tanks or they buy things because they don't have another way to resolve their problem. Mm-hmm. And so he buys this stupid robot which is presented by a military guy, and that's the end of the game.
Is this the last cutscene? Spoilers.
Yeah,
sorry, don't watch really this. Yeah. Or do I have to fight this robot now? I'm sure I have to fight this robot. Oh gosh. Yep. I have to fight the robot. I don't know. Take damage? No.
Yeah, just need to resist three times to this attack.
No, no,
yeah,
sir.
Yeah, try.
Yeah.
I don't even know any of the controls. You guys are putting me right in the boss fight.
This stick moves the character.
What?
That's the strafe. Now I can ask Michelle all my smart questions.
Well, where's the fire? There it is.
There you go. How do you feel seeing this game after all this time?
Sorry?
How do you feel about seeing this game after all this time? Do you think it holds up? Are you proud of this game?
Yeah. It's a game. You know, it's very important to when you're doing something like you have to love it, and it's part of you, part of your life, the time spent, people involved, and it's very interesting to see that. You know, just the way this boss is animated is just very, very cartoon animation, very snappy animation, and this is from guys that were making their first game. They were just doing, animation on paper, and it's interesting to see how they went from animation to this kind of thing. The achievement is interesting, making people working all together and creating this kind of thing. As a first project, and I think the Dreamcast version is maybe the most, the best rated game on the. You know, there is a rating for all the game of every all times. I think on Metacritic, this game is around 19. It's a 90, 92, 94%.
You did. I can't believe you did that.
You had a lot of help.
Way to make me look bad.
I think it's just a.
I kind of weakened. I kind of wore him out a little bit.
Yes, you did.
Do you think, after watching this and the way that you approach things and the themes of it, or anything, is there anything in this that you'd see in Wild? You're like, oh yeah, I've been doing Green Lips ever since. There's Green Lips in Wild. Is there anything like continued from your earlier games all the way into your most recent game?
The biggest thing is the trees. If you look at all my games, you've got these big roots, trees, and ancient forest, mysterious things, and that's really something I like the mystery behind this mix of nature and technology. And the beginning of Beyond Good and Evil is you have Jade, she's with close to a big oak, ancient oak, meditating. And it's, I don't know why all my games start like that with the trees, ancient trees. And sure. Wild now is really about nature, and you will have giant trees.
I'll look for that when I play Wild. The giant mysterious trees
with green lips, girls,
with green lips,
giant snakes.
You gotta put just
green lips.
One girl with green lips in Wild.
Any thorns in Wild? Any undulating thorn branches?
Any sexy thorns?
I think that's another point. The hidden thorn.
She eats something like a bunch of mint chocolate chip ice cream, and then she gets green lips in Wild. That'll be
absinthe. She drinks absinthe.
Yeah,
she's the green fairy, which was a nickname for absinthe.
That you craft yourself, of course.
Yeah.
Because you're never better served than when you do your own alcohol. That's every French people, you know what? They dream with they have this dream of making their own alcohol with those alambic. But it's forbidden now in France.
Really?
Expect if your ancestors had one, like, then you still have the right to use the one from your ancestors. You have to prove that your ancestors were doing that.
Really?
But otherwise, it's completely forbidden.
To have a still, like a distillery?
Yeah. So you can have your own distillery, but because people were doing some very extreme experience with those plants.
Funny, that robot looks like a camera facing Polly, but he moves as you, maybe his middle part moves around.
This robot was inspired by this Miyazaki movie, Castle in the Sky.
Yeah,
big robot, with wings and fire, able to climb. And,
Let's just cut to like a close up of us.
Yeah!
And we'll be like, he did it!
Yeah, wonderful!
Good job! Okay, well thank you for playing Rayman with us, Lee.
Yes. Thank you
for making Rayman and Rayman 2.
Everything, really.
I love playing this game. This is like, it's one of those games I play a little bit every night, and just all the sounds of it and stuff. It was just this routine that I really enjoy. It's a very special game to me, so thank you for making
thank
it.
Thank you.
Very inspirational. And thanks for coming out and playing.
Thank you.
Thanks for watching.
Bye.